The Tom Woods Show, episode 460.
Prepare to set fire to the index card of allowable opinion. Your daily dose of liberty education starts here. The Tom Woods Show.
Hey everybody, if you want to learn a new language without just having words barked at you, then I recommend Rocket Languages, where you really learn how the language works. Get a free mini course through tomwoods.com/rocket. Hey everybody, Tom Woods here, talking to Kevin Gutzman once again today. We're going to be talking about Thomas Jefferson, Andrew Jackson, the Democratic Party, and a whole lot more. You'll see why, what the occasion is for our discussion of these men in just a moment. I'll leave that to my discussion with Kevin. But what we're going to do is try to get to the bottom of whether these men were good from the point of view of liberty. Or maybe one of them was good and one was bad. Or maybe they're both bad. Well, you have to see what you think in just a moment when you hear our analysis of both of these men from the perspective of history. Kevin Gutzman is a professor of history at Western Connecticut State University, where he is also the chairman of the Department of History. Kevin is the author of several books, most recently James Madison and The Making of America. He's also the author of The Politically Incorrect Guide to the Constitution, which is an extraordinary book. All this stuff will be on today's show notes page, of course, tomwoods.com/460. And Kevin and I wrote a book together called Who Killed the Constitution? I produce a new episode of this show Monday through Friday, and this Friday I will be analyzing Thursday's Republican debate with Lou Rockwell. There's no way that's not going to be fun, so make sure you subscribe to the show over at tomwoods.com. Kevin, welcome back to the show.
I'm happy to be here, Tom.
Tell me about what the decision was that the Democrats in Connecticut and apparently in at least one other state made recently with regard to their special dinner. The Republicans have the Lincoln Day dinner in various states, and the Democrats had some other kind of dinner. What was that? And then we'll go into the significance of it.
Well, historically, Democrats in every state have had an annual fundraiser called the Jefferson-Jackson Dinner. And recently, the Connecticut Democratic Party decided to drop the names Jefferson and Jackson from the title of this dinner. On the other hand, Missouri, instead of dropping the names Jefferson and Jackson, decided to replace them with Harry S. Truman. So they're going to have the annual Harry S. Truman Democratic Party fundraising dinner, and Connecticut hasn't decided on a replacement name.
That's funny they would choose Truman. I don't know if you remember back in 1988 when the presidential race was between George H.W. Bush and Mike Dukakis. They were both trying to see which one could compare himself more effectively and convincingly to Harry Truman, neglecting the fact that when Truman left office, he had the lowest approval rating of any president since they've done modern polling, including Nixon when he resigned, was even more popular than Truman was. And that's the guy they want to imitate and name their dinner after.
Well, one supposes that the motivation of people in Missouri was primarily to identify themselves with a president from Missouri instead of...
Right.
But the thing is, of course, that the impetus for this in Connecticut came from the state NAACP, which in Connecticut, of course, as in many other states, is a very important part of the Democratic Party coalition. And so they were opposed to using the names Jefferson and Jackson due to the fact that Jefferson and Jackson both were slave owners. And it seemed to the NAACP that the Democratic Party should not be associated with the names of these terrible slave owners. Well, I guess terrible and slave owners, to their mind, is redundant. So decision was finally made that that should no longer be the title. And I find this somewhat of mixed impact in my mind. For one thing, I have for years told my undergraduates, and actually I guess I've told people in various other fora, that I thought the name Andrew Jackson should not be used as part of the title of these dinners. I think Andrew Jackson was an authentically capital B bad, capital G guy, and it's also surprising that the Democratic Party had continued to use his name because of their current ideological position. So I actually would have been happy to see him, his name removed from all 50 state Democratic fundraising dinners titles. This came up, or at least a related question came up recently when the Treasury Secretary announced that he was going to respond to a petition to put a woman on the $20 bill by removing Alexander Hamilton from the $10 bill and putting a woman there. And I thought that was exactly the wrong step. Actually, although I don't like the idea of an affirmative action face on any of these currency notes, surely getting rid of Jackson from the $20 bill would have been a good thing. But for various reasons. But the Jefferson, because he was a slave owner, it seems to me completely wrong-headed and so lamentable, although, of course, there is some truth in advertising in it, because the Connecticut Democratic Party is about as un-Jeffersonian as it could possibly be. So even those of us who have positive things to say about Jefferson could say, well, surely he wouldn't appreciate being associated with the Connecticut Democratic Party of today, which is a higher tax, big borrowing, intrusive government, redistributionist, anti-meritocracy party. But anyway, of course, we've also seen that there has grown to be a movement nationwide, and a kind of spasm, I guess, in recent weeks of people calling for taking down various monuments and so on. And a lot of that has to do with the same kind of impetus. People saying, well, we don't think that any monument that plausibly could be associated with slave owners or such ought to continue to stand. I think that's a somewhat different impulse from the one that was animating the two state Democratic parties. I would, of course, also be surprised if there weren't other state Democratic parties that followed the lead of Connecticut and Missouri and that also got rid of Jefferson or Jackson or both.
Well, let's go into that in a little more detail. I want to talk about both of these men briefly to get your opinion of them and why they do or don't belong. I mean, of course, you're right that the modern Democratic Party has nothing in common with Jefferson whatsoever, so it's better for them both for them to have this amicable split, I suppose. But let's start with Jefferson. First of all, what is wrong with the argument that Jefferson held slaves? This is so morally reprehensible that it has to outweigh whatever good he can be said to have done. So therefore, we have to take his name off. What's the problem with that thinking? Is there a problem with that thinking?
Well, I think that there is. I think it betrays a completely unhistorical cast of mind. You know, I, of course, encounter on a regular basis college freshmen whom I am trying to instruct about American history, and they go into thinking about the past with their 2015 blinders on, you know, and basically the idea is, well, anybody in the past who disagreed with any view that's common today or had any practice that would be considered wrong today is to be considered a dastardly fellow. But I think, you know, in light of or in keeping with the old adage that the past is a foreign country, it's more interesting to think about the way that people in the past related to their own circumstances. So take Jefferson. Jefferson was born I said in my biography of James Madison, Madison was born an American prince. So was Jefferson. He was born into the system of slave owning. He was born into a family that owned dozens and dozens of slaves, and in fact his mother's maiden name was Randolph, and the Randolph family was the most prominent network of slave owners in Virginia. Right now, there would be nothing interesting at all in somebody who was born into that, accepted it, lived comfortably with it, rode thoroughbred horses, lived in a castle, and so on. But Jefferson, on the other hand, although born into it, and this is true of George Washington too, actually, although Jefferson was born into this kind of comfort, He did not accept it, and in fact wrote against it, took legislative action against it, made rejected legislative proposals to ameliorate or even, he said, to end this situation. And ultimately his legacy in this regard was one of taking steps that helped to set slavery in the United States on a path toward ultimate extinction. Most notably, when he was president in 1806, he called on Congress to pass a law banning further importation of slaves as soon as the Constitution allowed. And so in 1807, he signed into law an act saying that beginning on January 1, 1808, slave importation would be illegal. Well, that was as soon as the Constitution allowed Congress to do that. And people, at the time that the Constitution was being considered for ratification, people didn't think that Congress would actually use this power at the earliest possible date. There was every reason to believe, as some pro-ratification advocates said, that this meant that slave importations would go on indefinitely. If slave importations had gone on for another 20 or 30 years, the population would have been much, much more enslaved, much more African, much more of the economy would have been slavery-centered than ultimately was the case. So this was a very important step. If that had been the only thing that Jefferson did about slavery, it would have been a very important anti-slavery career that he had, but that was not the only thing he did about slavery. He took several other steps about slavery, and he wrote about this question of the morality of slavery, which, you know, got him into disputes with some of his fellow Virginia Republican leaders, notably John Taylor, another very notable Virginia political thinker of the late 18th and early 19th centuries. So what's the point? The point is, again, there'd be nothing interesting about a guy who was born a slave owner, owned slaves, and then died, right? There's nothing interesting about a guy who's born the dictator, the son of a dictator, his father dies, he becomes a dictator, and then he dies. But what would be interesting would be if, you know, Assad succeeded his father as the dictator of Syria and then said, you know, I don't think having a dictator is a good thing. I don't want to be the dictator. This kind of thing doesn't happen very often, right? Think about kings who've done it. Well, the current king of Spain did something similar to that. But it's very, very unusual for somebody to do what Jefferson did. George Washington is another fellow from Virginia who did the same kind of thing, and he's actually somebody else whose name has been kind of sullied in recent years by people who said, well, slaveholders are awful, we shouldn't be naming parks and buildings and so on after them. It wasn't very many years ago that the city of New Orleans decided to rename a public school that had been named after George Washington because they said he was a slave owner. Well, yes, George Washington was a slave owner. Same kind of story as Jefferson, except for the last couple of decades of his life, he decided that he thought slavery was immoral. He stopped buying and selling people. He did not kick them off of his plantation, but by the time he died, he had about a third more slaves on his farms than he even could use. There was not work for them to do. And why? Finally, because he thought it would be a bad thing for them to sell them. It would be a bad thing for them to expel them. There were actually people he asked, do you want to leave? And they told him, no, I don't want to leave Mount Vernon. In his will, he freed them. So how are we to understand George Washington as a man who owned slaves? Well, yes. But how about this? As a man who freed them. What about that? So it seems to me that this is kind of the story of America. We would like that to be George Washington's story. We would like that to be the story of the whole country. America had slaves, and then it freed them, right? No, let's just forget about these people, right? Let's just forget about them. We'll pretend that everybody in the past was born into a society with our current sensibilities, and if they offended our current sensibilities in any way, say by inheriting slaves, and by the way, of course, inheriting slaves was not something that somebody decided to do, right? That was just like inheriting your height. You didn't have a choice. So anyway, I think Thomas Jefferson fits more or less into the Washington category, and it's ridiculous that to be removing his name from any monument. I think actually that George Washington should be remembered more than he is.
Kevin, the outrage that people have against the sort of people you're talking about have against Jefferson or Washington seems highly selective too. It's be one thing if these people were just delicate flowers who were offended by absolutely everything, but they're not offended by absolutely everything. They're offended by somebody who held slaves 200 years ago, and they act as if that's the only aspect of their lives that's worth mentioning, but they're not offended at all by atrocities that occurred in their own lifetimes. And of course, by that I'm referring to the atrocities of communism, which are not talked about. There aren't monuments to them. There are almost never any motion pictures about them. There's no mention about them at all. If somebody's walking around in a hammer and sickle T-shirt, there's no member of the Democratic Party who's going to be offended by that in the slightest bit. They'll say, well, you know, he's just a misplaced idealist. That's what they'll say. So it's a little bit hard for me to take any of this seriously.
It's interesting that you say that, because the latest issue of the Journal of American History, which is a scholarly journal of the Organization of American Historians.
Oh, I know. I know. All right, tell me what's in it.
Well, it has a book review section, and it has a review this month in which the reviewer says it's a happy thing that there really are no significant popular memorials or historical sites one can go to see any positive account of the American victory in the Cold War. So this is a great thing, says the reviewer. We shouldn't have what he calls the right-wing narrative of the Cold War, which, I think in Eastern Europe is generally regarded as, I don't know, the Polish or the Lithuanian or the Belarusian or the Bulgarian narrative of the Cold War, that ultimately the Soviet communists cease grinding these people under their boot. This is not something that Americans seem to be that interested in. My own feeling is that basically the media and the popular culture don't ever say anything about these things, and so your average Joe or Jane doesn't even know anything about them. I know that my students typically aren't very well versed in these kinds of matters. But back to what you were saying about the Democratic establishment. Yes, it is true. Actually, it's especially true in Connecticut, where recently in one of our large towns, the local Democratic Party bought from the local communists a building to be their new headquarters. You might think, well, why are those two separate organizations? That's a good question. I'm kidding a little bit there. but I think there are two different issues here. One is whether the politicians and the political groups like the NAACP are trying to be manipulative by calling for removing these names from the dinners and taking down monuments and so on. There's that. Yes, you're right. Those people aren't tender flowers who are offended by every thought of Thomas Jefferson. On the other hand, there are other people. For example, the NAACP is not all black people, right? It's not all black Southerners. And I think I know some, that there are black Southerners who have a particular attitude about some of the monuments and the flag and so on, that are similar to what the NAACP says about them. These are people who are not political activists, or not. Some of them, actually, I know are conservative Republican black people from the South who don't like, for example, the battle flag of the Army of Northern Virginia. And why not? Well, because beginning in 1948, it was made into the symbol of segregation and anti-civil rights, and let's keep blacks disfranchised, George Wallace, and so on. So on one hand, one doesn't want to concede any point to the politically vicious people who are attacking bygone American heroes. On the other hand, one doesn't want the impulse to resist whatever bad people call for to blind one to the fact that there are actually good, decent people who would rather not have these symbols everywhere. For example, right now there's controversy in South Carolina over a monument to an early 20th century politician named Ben Tillman. Tillman was nothing but an anti-black demagogue. I mean, he called repeatedly in public for horrible violence against black people. And he ultimately held the highest political offices in the South Carolina electorate's gift. And there's a prominent monument to him. My own feeling is that ought to come down. I mean, I think, you know, part of the issue here is that we had apartheid in much of the country. We had a system in which blacks were kept from voting, and we have a lot of monuments that are actually to people who were primarily or prominently responsible for establishing and maintaining that kind of system. One should expect that once the formerly degraded people were given the vote, eventually those monuments would be removed. They're not going to want to celebrate Ben Tillman. Why should they celebrate? And why should we want to celebrate Ben Tillman? Why should we want to oppose taking down a statue of Ben Tillman? So I do think that we want to avoid thinking, well, anyone who calls for taking down any kind of monument anywhere is equivalent to somebody who wants to rename George Washington Elementary School because George Washington was a slave owner, right? These are different kinds of issues.
Right, and I totally understand that. I think what a lot of people think, though, is that we've been through this before, and we know that when the left gets onto something, even when it has decent people on its side, that's just by accident, that's pure happenstance, they don't stop with the just one small demand that they have. They never say, we're satisfied with the way the world is now. That no leftist is ever going to say that. It's permanent revolution. And if you yield a few inches, they're going to take 15 miles. And so I understand why people dig in their heels, because they know the nature of the opponent that they're facing. I also appreciate your point of view, which is that, you know, a broken clock is right twice a day, and that sometimes there are perfectly decent people who call for things like taking down a statue of Ben Tillman. So we have to have a nuanced and subtle view of matters like this. Kevin, let's pause for just a minute for this message. Hey, everybody, if you want to learn a new language, I strongly recommend Rocket Languages. I told you guys a story in a recent episode of trying to learn French in graduate school, and they had adopted this fashionable new method of just barking French words at you, thinking that you'll learn a language when you're 20 or 25 the same way you learn it when you're 2 years old. Well, obviously that's not true. You have to understand the structure of the language. I was begging them to teach me the structure of the language and not just bark words at me. Well, they refused, so I learned no French whatsoever, and it was a total waste of my time. But I finally found Rocket Languages, which teaches languages the way I would if I were structuring a language program. I learn the words, I learn vocabulary, but I also learn the structure of the language, and I get lessons I can listen to on the go in my car. Check out a free mini course through tomwoods.com/rocket. Kevin, I do want to make sure that we don't wrap up without talking about the other of the two presidents that the Democrats want to separate themselves from, because it's very rare that you would agree with the New York Times or whatever on something, for different reasons, no doubt, or sometimes the same reasons, I suppose. But the Andrew Jackson question, there are plenty of libertarians who are willing to say, all right, I know about the Trail of Tears, but basically he was a limited government states' rights guy, with the exception of nullification. That takes states' rights too far, he would say. But he believed in equal rights for everyone, which meant no group or industry should get any special privilege from the government. So the whole package sounds kind of libertarian. So what's wrong with him?
Oh, boy. Well, first of all,
I set that one up right over the plate for you, Kevin.
Well, there are several things. Ultimately, Andrew Jackson was a lawless demagogue. I mean, that's what he came down to. So, for example, you say, well, there is the matter of nullification. Yes, what happened in the nullification crisis, ultimately, and we won't summarize the whole political campaign about nullification, but Jackson ultimately asked Congress to pass what was called the Force Bill, which it did, and what this did was empower the president to use the army against the state in case the state should resist federal law. So, to my mind, and this was also the position of every Democratic president who was alive during the Civil War, This was unconstitutional. That was Buchanan's position. That was Pierce's position. It was Tyler's position. Of course, Tyler actually, at the time, was a senator who voted against the force bill and in doing so announced that he was leaving the Democratic Party. This was completely contrary to the classic Virginian position on federalism, which said essentially that, yes, there obviously the federal government had rightful powers, but the federal government also had no right to be using the military against the state. So that's one thing. Another thing is, of course, people are most prone to laud him for that taking out after the Bank of the United States. And I agree that the second bank, like the first bank, was unconstitutional. However, there was a statute calling on the Treasury, saying that the Treasury Secretary had to deposit federal revenue in this bank whose constitutionality had been upheld by the federal courts. And Jackson told his Treasury Secretary to remove the deposits from the bank. The Treasury Secretary refused to do so, and Jackson fired him. He then appointed a second Treasury Secretary. He called him in, told him to remove the deposits from the bank. That guy also, this was 2 days, I think it took 2 days for this guy's nomination to be confirmed. So it was within a week of the first guy being fired. He calls in the second guy, tells him to remove the deposits from the bank. He says no as well. Jackson fires him too. He then turns to his attorney general, whom he makes Treasury Secretary. That guy was named Roger Brooke Taney. Taney, told by Jackson to remove the deposits from the bank, essentially said, how soon? And Jackson responded to this willingness to violate the law on Taney's part by making him Chief Justice. As Chief Justice, Taney, Jackson's appointee, was responsible for the Dred Scott decision, which, in which case Taney wrote an opinion that was completely divorced from any valid account of the Constitution's framing and ratification. I mean, basically he said that the people who made the Constitution all agreed that no black could be a citizen of the United States, even if he were free. The assumption was that none would be. There's no truth in this. There were two dissents in the case, and both of them explained that when the Constitution was ratified, there were several states where blacks voted. Before Taney ultimately made his opinion in the case public, he had read these dissents, and this is very unusual. He changed parts of his opinion to respond to these dissents. Although, of course, he could not contradict the main point, which was that it was just untrue. He also said that the portion of the Missouri Compromise that kept slavery out of the northernmost territories was unconstitutional. This was also untrue. And so I blame Jackson for Taney's performance as Chief Justice. The lawlessness Taney displayed in Dred Scott was exactly like the lawlessness he displayed in his willingness to remove the deposits when Jackson told him to. This is all just partisan Democratic behavior, as we're accustomed to seeing from the four Democrats who are on the Supreme Court today. They will basically say whatever President Obama wants them to say in these cases about Obamacare, for example. Historians generally agree, in fact, I can't think of one who disagrees, that at least up to Roe versus Wade, Dred Scott was the worst decision in the court's history, and it was just classic Jacksonian behavior. Jackson also was a really bad guy. I mean, if you said something negative about him in print or in public, and he thought you were beneath his social level, he would find you and beat you with a cane or a whip in public. He did this on numerous occasions. If he thought you were on his social level, he would duel you. There was one case where he shot a guy between the eyes, and then he himself slumped to the ground. And when the doctor came over and said, General Jackson, you've been shot, Jackson's response was, did he see it? Like he wanted to know whether in the 2 seconds between his being shot and his killing the other guy had the pleasure of knowing that he had hit Jackson. So Jackson was a nasty kind of a fellow. And of course, the most notorious thing he did was probably the Trail of Tears episode, where he flouted two correct decisions from the Supreme Court that the Indians in Georgia were entitled to the benefit of the treaties they had made with Georgia to keep their land in Georgia, and signed legislation requiring them to move to what is now Oklahoma, and then send his own agents to force them to do this in the winter. So these people were walking from Georgia to Oklahoma in the winter. About half of them died on the way. This, again, I think, is just abominable behavior. And it's not 2015 ethics or a 2015 kind of sentimentality that leads me to this conclusion. People thought this stuff was appalling at the time. Many people thought this was appalling at the time. So I don't know what there is in what I've just said that the Democratic Party would want to be associated with today. He formerly was seen as a kind of heroic military figure for winning the Battle of New Orleans. Oh, I left out one other thing. He actually, during the Monroe administration, he was ordered by the War Secretary, John C. Calhoun, not to invade Florida. Jackson, the commander of the U.S. Army in the Southeast, then invaded Florida anyway. And they had long discussions in the cabinet over whether to relieve him, which is what Calhoun, his immediate superior, wanted to do. Ultimately, they decided not to relieve him because the Secretary of State realized that the ease with which Jackson had conquered Florida would be a good negotiating point. And so he wrote to the King of Spain and said, well, we told our general not to invade Florida, and he did it anyway, so we wish that hadn't happened, but you see how easy it was. Now the question for you is, do you want us to pay you for Florida? And, you know, in other words, or do you want us to take it for free? So Jackson, at every stage of his political career, was just a really, he was an insubordinate general who launched an aggressive war. He was a scofflaw when it came to the Trail of Tears. He appointed the Chief Justice who made literally the worst decision, at least up to 1973, in the history of the Supreme Court. And he had the Congress adopt the Force Bill, which established the principle that the federal government could use the army against the state. And, of course, we know eventually that was used. So I don't know, again, I don't know what there is about Jackson that anybody would want to commemorate. I think he was a thug myself, and I'm happy with the idea of him being removed from the 20, although, of course, in its classic fashion, it seems that the Obama administration has decided not to remove him from the 20. They're going to take Hamilton off the 10, which is a different issue.
Indeed, and I have a debate coming up in New York City in December on the general subject of the merits of Hamilton in terms of the overall cause of liberty. So I'm looking forward to that. And I'm going to tell people, of course, that if you like listening to Kevin Gutzman, you say, oh my gosh, I never knew this stuff. This is great. Well, this is what Liberty Classroom is. It's like libertyclassroom.com is like what you just heard times 100,000. Like, that's what we do over there in the forums and our live sessions and the on-the-go courses you can download and listen to at any time. Or if you like video, you can watch video. Kevin's got several courses up there that are going to open your eyes about all kinds of historical topics, and more courses to come, no doubt, once you finish this book project that you're working on. I guess you must be getting close to the end.
I am very nearly done, yes.
It's on Thomas Jefferson. Should we say anything else?
Well, it's called Thomas Jefferson Revolutionary, and I am hopeful that it will be published early next year.
And is the publisher St. Martin's?
It is, yes. I'm happy to say I'm still with the same Macmillan imprint. Apparently they liked me.
That is a real feather in your cap. That's absolutely great. Well, Kevin, thanks so much for your time today. Always appreciated.
Happy to do it, Tom.
All right, before I reveal tomorrow's episode topic, I'll just remind you that if you've been meaning to start that blog, you want to start that website, you don't know where to begin, I have a free website book for you at freewebsitebook.com. Takes you step by step in 5 minutes. You can have that blog up, you can get that stuff off your chest, but it's not just for getting stuff off your chest, it can also help you professionally. For reasons I explain, I've got strategies in the book at freewebsitebook.com. And remember, when you go to get your web hosting, I'm a VIP affiliate of Bluehost, so I can get you the best price on hosting there is through tomwoods.com/blue. Tomorrow, if all goes well, we're going to talk here on the show about Bernie Sanders his ideas and whether any of them hold water. I think you probably know where I'm going to go with that, but people have been begging me for an episode on Bernie Sanders, and your wish is my command. Remember today's show notes page, tomwoods.com/460, and we'll see you tomorrow.
Become a smarter libertarian in just 30 minutes a day. Visit tomwoods.com to subscribe to the show for free, and we'll see you next time.